Hello students, welcome to the MOOCs program. I hope you have been following all the other modules that have been provided to you. Myself, Mukul Raizada, I am assistant professor at National Law University, Delhi. I'll be dealing today with the module named Place of Inquiry and Trial. This module will help us understanding the rules, the basic rules of the place of inquiry and trial. This module will also help us in understanding the rules pertaining to the issues of territorial jurisdiction where the basic rules are difficult to apply. We will also know the provisions meant for the relief when the objections relating to territorial jurisdiction is raised. Now let us begin with the module. Chapter 13 of the Criminal Procedure Code is titled Jurisdiction of the Courts in Inquiry and Trial. This chapter 13 deals with the criminal jurisdiction of the criminal courts in inquiries and trials. Section 177 to section 186 of the Criminal Procedure Code, which is contained in this chapter 13, deals with the place of inquiry and trials. The crime basically is local in nature, and the jurisdiction over the crime belongs to the place where the crime is committed. This rule is also manifested in the basic rule provided under section 177, and it follows the common law rule that proper venue for inquiry or trial is in the jurisdiction in which the facts constituting the crime occurred. This rule promotes expediency in the sense that investigation of the trial and availability of the witnesses to be examined to prove the commission of the crime and the convenience of the prosecution and the defense are both taken care of. Place of occurrence of incidents and not the place where the complaint was filed or the FIR was lost should be taken into consideration while determining the territorial jurisdiction where the case is to be tried. Chapter 13 of CRPC should be read as a follow-up to section 156 subsection 1, which talks about the territorial jurisdiction of the police officer to investigate the crime. It is important to note that police officer has power to investigate any offense which would be triable under this chapter 13 by the court having a local jurisdiction where the police station is situated. This enables the police officer to investigate certain offenses even though they are outside the local limits of his police station. Another fallout of this general rule provided under section 177 is that in cases where there is a doubt that a particular offense has taken place in which area, any court having a local jurisdiction in which that offense has taken place partially can inquire or try that offense. So the basic rule under section 177 is that any court within whose local jurisdiction the offense was committed or the place where the act constituted in the crime occurred shall be the place of its inquiry or trial. This was held in Ravi Shankar Pal versus State of Uttar Pradesh 2014. Also in Rajendra Ramachandran Kevalkar versus State of Maharashtra AIR 2009 Supreme Court, it was held that the basis of determination is the place of occurrence of the incident and the averments made in the charge sheet. Regarding the term ordinarily that is used under section 177, it has been held in Y. Abraham Ajit versus Inspector of Police AIR 2004 Supreme Court that a general rule that it is a general rule and not an exclusive one and is subject to certain special provisions. In K. Bhaskaran versus Shankaran 1999, it was held that it is not an unexceptional or unchangeable rule. Supreme Court in 1961 in Purushottam Das Dalmia held that the exception provided to 177 are inclusive of considerations other than the prescribed under the law. This common law rule, which provides for the jurisdiction of courts where the crime has been committed, takes care of those cases where the case commenced and is completed within the same jurisdiction of the same court. But there may be instances where a crime is committed under one place and is completed in some other place. Or there may be circumstances where crime is committed through various acts being committed in different areas. Or crime may be of a continuous nature. Or another instance can be that crime is committed during the voyage or the journey. Or it may so happen that a crime is committed at a particular place, far off or distance from that place, through letters or telecommunications. The problem arises that in these special circumstances, how to decide the territorial jurisdiction of the court to inquire or try those cases. Here comes the significance of the limitations that acts an exception to this general rule provided by Section 177. This module, we will be dealing by dividing it into four major components. The first two components or the categories would be talking about the exception to the rule of 177, that is the basic rule of inquiry and trial. The first amongst this is the alternatives to the Section 177, which are based upon the constituting elements of the crime that affects the place of inquiry or trial. The second is the alternatives which are based on factors or circumstance other than the constituent element of the crime that affects the place of inquiry and trial. The remaining two modules will take care of, firstly, how and when the objections in relation to the territorial jurisdiction are raised and what are the powers of the High Court in that respect. And lastly, what are the powers of magistrate to inquire into a crime which has been committed beyond its jurisdiction, and what are the special power of the state government to direct a case to some other session division. So in the first part, we have seen that Section 177 of the CRPC talks about the basic rule of place of inquiry and trials. Now, in the second part, we will deal with some of the alternatives that are provided in the same Chapter 13 of the CRPC, that how and in what conditions they apply as an exception to the rule provided by Section 177 that talks of the basic rule. There may be certain cases where there is a doubt as to the local jurisdiction of the court, and in such cases, the Section 178 provides an alternative. Section 178 applies to those situations where a doubt arises that which magistrate has the power to inquire or try the case. Section 178 can be resorted if the prosecution is able to establish any of the grounds that are following. Number one, in case of uncertainty as to the local area of commission of an offence, Section 178 provides that any court, either of this district or the other district, can inquire or try that case. This was held in Punaradyo Narayan Singh versus Ram Sarup Roy in way back 1898 in Calcutta. Offences committed partly in one local area and partly in some other local area. In such situation, Section 178 subsection B provides that any of the two courts can inquire or try the case. This was held in Mangal Das Raghavji versus State of Maharashtra in 1968. In case of an offense that continues from one local area to some other local area, any court that has jurisdiction over any such local area may inquire into or try such offense. This is provided under section 178 subsection C. It was held in State versus Deokaran in 1973 that a continuing offense is one which is susceptible to continuance and is distinguishable from the one which is committed once and for all. Similarly, in Manik Biswas versus State of Chhattisgarh in 2009, it was held that offense under section 498A of Indian Penal Code is triable by any court of any such place where it took place or continued. In cases an offense consists of several acts performed in different local areas, any court having jurisdiction over any such area may inquire or try such offense. This is provided under section 178 subsection D. Another alternative is provided under section 179, which can only be applied in those cases where consequence is an essential ingredient of an offense and without which act would not be punishable in itself. This section 179 is applicable in cases where an accused is to be tried for an offense for his act that he performed as well as the consequence that took place because of his act. Any court where either his act performed by him or the consequence that followed his act were committed, any court can inquire or try that offense. It was held in Satwan Singh in 1960 that both the courts where the act was performed or the court under whose jurisdiction the consequence took place are capable of taking cognizance. Similarly, in 2010, in Ashish Nandi versus State of Gujarat, it was held that offense is a cumulative effect of act done and consequence ensued. Similarly, one more alternative to section 177 is section 180. This section deals with the alternative jurisdiction based upon related offense. Now the question arises, what is a related offense? An act where an act is an offense by reason of its relation with some other act which is also an offense, then both these offenses are called as related offense. And any court, any of the two courts where either of the act has been committed can inquire into or try the case. This we can understand with the help of two examples. First being the offense of receiving a stolen property. In such type of offenses, any court either where the offense of theft took place or the court where property was dishonestly received can inquire into or try the offense. Similarly, in the case of offense of abatement, both the principal and the abettor can jointly be tried at either of the court where in the first instance the offense of abatement was committed or the offense abated was committed. We can understand the implication of section 179 with the help of an example, that how the cases where consequence is an ingredient offense, the exception applies to the general rule of section 177. Let us take an example. Suppose a person is wounded within a local jurisdiction of a particular court and he moves on to another jurisdiction of some other court and there he dies as a consequence of that wounding. Now in this case, both the courts where the person was initially wounded and the later court where the person ultimately died because of those wounds, any of these courts can go into the inquiry of the offense and also try the offense. So this is how we have looked to some of the exception to the basic rule of section 177, that what are the circumstances or what are the categories of offenses where the exception to rule 177 applies. One thing is important to note, that all these exceptions mentioned in section 178, section 179 and section 180 is basically dependent upon the constituent element of the offense that affects, and it affects the place of inquiry and trial. In the next part, we'll be dealing with some other instances of the limitations of section 177, which will focus on those cases where some factors or circumstance other than the constituent element of crime will affect the place of inquiry and trial. So in second part, we have seen how the constituent element of the crime affects the place of inquiry and trial. Now our focus will move on to the cases where factors or circumstance other than the constituent element of the crime will affect the place of inquiry and trial. And for this, we will look to section 181 onwards. Section 181 provides for the cases where offender is proceeding from one place to another. This section deals with the cases where an offender proceeds from one local jurisdiction in India to some other local jurisdiction in India. Examples can be he being a thug or a dacoit, or he is escaping from the custody, offenses involving kidnapping and abduction, offense of theft and possession of stolen property, offenses of extortion and robbery, criminal misappropriation and criminal breach of trust. Second alternative is provided under section 182, which talks of the place of trial for offenses committed by letter, etc. If it has resulted in case of deception, or deception is practiced from distance, or in case any property is delivered at two different places, or in case an offense under section 494 or 495 of Indian Penal Code has been committed, then any of the court can exercise its jurisdiction over any of these two places. Thirdly, under section 183, the place of trial for offenses committed on journey or voyage is taken into consideration. At any place where either the victim passed through or the offender passed through or the property passed through, every such court is competent to look into the case for inquiry or for the trial. Fourthly, under section 184, which talks of place of trial for offenses triable together, it provides for the venue of trial in cases of joinder of charge and in cases of joinder of persons permissible at one trial. It was held in State of Karnataka versus M. Balakrishnan in 1980 that any court competent to try any of the said offense, for example, trial for kidnapping and rape, can be held at either place. Similarly, section 188 takes care of the cases which includes place of trial for offenses committed outside India. This section provides for the situation where an offense has been committed outside India, either by an Indian citizen or on the high sea or elsewhere, or by a person not being an Indian citizen on any ship or aircraft registered in India. In both these scenarios, the court can take into consideration the case and can try the case at the place of his actual presence. This section can also be considered as a procedural counterpart of section 4 of Indian Penal Code. Now we move on to the last component of this module, major component of this module, which talks of when the objection is raised as to the territorial jurisdiction. When a question is raised in respect of the territorial or local jurisdiction of the court is required to deal with that objection first and only then it can proceed with the trial. This objection to the local jurisdiction of the court can be raised at any stage of the trial, but court can decide this question only after taking cognizance of the case. Court at the same time cannot avoid this objection in the light of Section 462 CRPC, since Section 462 CRPC comes into play or is available only in those cases where court, having no territorial jurisdiction on the crime, goes on with the trial and decides the case, or the objection relating to the territorial objection has not been raised till the time the court has decided the case. If a magistrate who does not have any local jurisdiction over the case goes on with the trial and decides the case, this amounts to irregularity which can be cured under Section 462 of the Criminal Procedure Code. Now we will look to the power of high courts to decide the district in case of doubt that where inquiry or trial should take place. Section 186 of the CRPC under Chapter 13 provides the rule that where there is a doubt as to which subordinate court should inquire into or try the case, it is the High Court which shall decide the matter. It is further provided that where the courts are subordinate to the same High Court, then the concerned High Court shall decide the question. And in cases where the courts are subordinate to two different High Court, then the High Court within whose local limit the criminal appellate jurisdiction the proceeding began first shall decide the question. In G. Sri Ramallu versus V. Rangaswamy in 1978, the court held that Section 186 of Section B is applicable when cases are common arising out of the same transaction and with the same parties. Similarly, Section 185 of the same chapter provides for the cases and provides the power to the state government in cases where a particular offense has already been committed to be tried in a particular district to direct that case in some other session division. But such direction from the state government should not be in a contravention to any previous direction given by either the High Court or the Session Court. Similarly, in Section 187, it provides that where a person who is within the local jurisdiction of a magistrate commits an offense beyond his jurisdiction, the same magistrate can inquire into that case and can compel the person to appear before him. And later on, the magistrate shall direct that person to be present before the magistrate in whose jurisdiction he has committed the crime. So, to conclude the things, we have seen that crime is considered local and hence it should ideally be inquired into and tried at a place where it occurred by the court which has the local jurisdiction at that place. But we have also seen that there might be certain situations where the applicability of this general rule is not that easy. So, this chapter 13 also provides certain exceptions to the rule of Section 177. These exceptions we have further divided into two categories, that is, exceptions where the constituent element of the crime becomes a deciding factor to decide the place of inquiry and trial, such as when the consequence is of a significant importance, or when the offense is a related offense, it is a continuing offense, where there is an uncertainty as to where the offense has been committed. All those things we covered in the first part. In the second category of exceptions, which talks about factors or the circumstance other than the constant element that decides the place of inquiry and trial, wherein we have seen where the offense has been committed by letters, offense has been committed on journey or voyage, offense has been committed outside India, all those situations we have covered. So in the light of these two exceptions provided to section 177, we can say the Criminal Procedure Code provides and takes care of all the eventualities that the offender does not get any benefit of any loophole in the provisions regarding to place of inquiry and trial. Similarly, in this module, we have also seen that how and when the objection in relation to the place of inquiry and trial can be raised, and what are the powers of the High Court to decide these type of questions. Similarly, we have also looked into the limited power of the state government to direct a case out of one district to some other session division, and also the exceptional power of the magistrate under section 187 to inquire into a case which has been committed beyond his limitation. I hope you have followed this module. Thanks.